Frank Gehry is simply one of the great architects of our time. His work has created a new language of structural shapes and designs by pushing the boundaries of the field both technologically and artistically. Yet his process always begins with an idea, a simple doodle, and a chemistry with his client. With the completion of the Guggenheim Museum Bilbao in 1998, Gehry's acclaim went to a new level. That building had been hailed as one of the most important structures of the 20th century. Now at age 72, Frank Gehry's work is being featured in a full museum retrospective at the Guggenheim Museum here in New York. Frank Gehry Architect will run through August 26. Recently, I spent an hour with him talking about his work and the Guggenheim.
When you look at this famous museum designed by another famous architect,
Frank II.
I mean, what do you see out here? What is all this?
It's my life.
There's Gehry's life. I mean, if you don't see it here.
In the middle of Mr. Wright.
Yeah.
Well, I like this building. I always have. And I enjoyed the intervention of making these. You see, the backlit photographs detach this rail so it looks like it's floating more than it usually does. And I had fun doing that. Mm-hmm. And then these funny things which aren't finished yet, which may never be finished. Mm-hmm. This was an attempt to make a groined dome ceiling. So it was a historic reference.
Yeah.
And it didn't quite come off yet. And it didn't come off because the material, we only got half of the delivery. And when you load this thing half, you can't pull these things. It had to be symmetrically loaded anyway.
Don't be embarrassed by the question. What do you think you share with the man who designed this building?
Well, he certainly had a passion for his work, right. And I do that. He believed in himself, and I'm not quite as sure of myself as he was, or he acted like he was. I don't know if he really
that's
was.
That's a very good point.
He sure put on a good act, and maybe it was the times were different, and these are friendlier times. Friendlier time for architect vis-a-vis the rest of the world. When he was doing that stuff, it was hard. The world wasn't that interested. And technology wasn't there. He was trying things that's the other thing. The textile block things he had tried stuff with materials. And I actually drove all the way across country once. I was at Harvard, and I drove cross country with my kids in a little Volkswagen to see Wright at Taliesin West. And the flag was up, and he was there. And I thought, and I went to the gate, and they wanted $1 a person, and I told them to shove it. My liberal thing was, I couldn't deal with that, you know. So his politics were quite at odds with what I would be. But
you had the same philosophy about architecture.
Organic. Yep, certainly.
Breaking
but that's
ground.
About humanism and about making buildings that relate to people. I mean, that's why we make them. They shouldn't be just an abstract container that you look at from the distance and you go, oh, it's got to have something to do with.
It is interesting. I mean, one of his famous buildings was a Guggenheim. One of your famous buildings is a Guggenheim.
Yeah.
His came at the end of the career. Yours in the midst of a career.
Yeah.
But it ignited
the rest of the career.
The rest of it.
A little too much ignition. Yeah. I want to slow down the
burn. How do you live with that notion that, you know, you don't want to repeat yourself.
Right.
You don't want to spend the rest of your life designing Bilbaos.
Nope.
You know? On the other hand, you don't want to run for what is truly one of the great buildings of the second half of the 20th century.
Well, you know, I'm human, so I can't escape what I can do. And what I've developed a language over a period of time. It culminated in Bilbao. and I'm going beyond. By the time Bilbao was done, there were four or five other buildings in the can, as it were. So I think the problem is not to get self-conscious about it and just go on. And as soon as you start to believe the press, believe, you know, that you think I'm okay, I'm in trouble.
But you look at what you did in Germany, it's dramatically different.
Yes. It was a different context, a different set of conditions. I enjoyed the Berlin building because the constraints were interesting. They were about a conflict that the Berliners, the Germans, were having about who they were. And it was interesting from that standpoint. Half the town wanted to rebuild the 19th century. Half the town, I mean, the German history of architecture is way up there. You know, they've got a legacy that's beyond belief in terms of, so there's a lot of intellect, architectural intellect, coming to bear. They're struggling with this, who they are, modern 19th century, go back, make the thing, you know. That was interesting. And so I was right in that slot, and the guy who was in charge of it, some of my colleagues have had, like Eisman's had trouble with him, others the modernists have had trouble with him. I had an easy time with him because I took his controls, his thing, and I said, okay, it's his country, it's their rules, I understand their conflict. I took his controls and I pushed, I came back with innovative solutions within his constraints. And he accepted them. And it was interesting. The only thing they fought me on was I didn't want to put a mullion. I had these big windows, and they wanted a vertical mullion to split it to reproportion the windows. And I didn't fight it. I just said, look, you're going to ruin the whole design. Is it really that important? And we negotiated, and they let it out. They let it go.
So basically you said to them, I'm not going to fight you on this, but if you do it, you'll ruin the whole building.
Yeah, right.
If you want to,
my mother taught me that.
Very smart.
Jewish guilt is called.
Do what you want to do, but just understand.
Right.
How stupid it is.
Right.
When you think about this language that you created that came to fruition at Bilbao, what are you talking about? Language. The language of architecture. The language of Gehry.
It's a personal exploration in form, in surface. It has to do with my do-gooder intentions, which are, you know, suspect at best. But I come from that, and so the idea is, how do you make a building that connects with people, that has an emotion, gives you something, and it doesn't resort to copying the 19th century or resort to 19th century detail or decoration or whatever. So I was looking for a way to fit into my time, to use the technology of now the best I can, push it if I could, push it, and I know where the edge is, I've found many edges, and try and make a building that has some passion in it. And I got into this movement thing, but you know, if you go into history, Phidias was interested in movement. The Indian sculptors were interested in movement. And with inert materials. And you see it in art, in sculpture. And so why can't a building do that? And I looked at the funny fish, which were architectural to me. I think because of the Japanese woodcut drawings that I liked, that it became, I just fastened on it. It wasn't because of my grandmother and gefilte fish and all that. It was really, it was serendipitous in a way that I started looking at it, but they did become architectural to me. And I made the fish shapes.
Right.
I even made a few terrible ones with the tails and everything. And as I explored it, then I cut those off and abstracted it. And then Bilbao is part of that study. So it's a language that's interested in making something that has feeling. And movement is certainly...
These are the so-called folds.
Yeah. Well, the folds are different. The folds are a little different. I mean, your mother's arm when you were a baby, there's a primitive thing. There's a, I think, that we respond to fold and so I've...
Because it's a place to...
Yeah, but your first experience is with fabric is in fold.
Are you thinking of this when you design?
Yes, yeah. I look at paintings a lot. I look at sculpture a lot. I look at, I was saying earlier, the issues of surface. If you look at the surface of Bilbao, it's titanium because titanium was the best material I could find to deal with the local light. It turned golden in the rain. I was knocked out when I saw it. I had a little piece. I had it on a post in L.A. outside my office. It rained. I went out and looked at it, and it looked golden. I said, we've got to use that. And then how do you fasten it? I mean, they're rectilinear pieces, so you can't have rough edges. You can't do painterly things with it. How do you make a surface that is attractive, that engages you, makes you feel comfortable with it? You want to touch it with metal. And so we did a lot of experiments with panels and textures and so on.
You needed technology to be able to, by that we mean computers primarily, to be able to do what you've been able to do.
Right.
You know, Frank Lloyd Wright couldn't have done this because he would not have known.
Right. The guy who would, if Mendelssohn, Eric Mendelssohn,
right,
had been alive today, I would have been preempted. He would have gotten there first because he was exploring some of the things I'm doing, but he never got to do it.
But did you build on what you knew about him?
Yes, I had an early experience with him. I met him.
Yeah.
He was an arrogant son of a gun, but when I was a student and he came to the school and talked and he very much impressed me and I studied him.
Your earliest friends were artists, not architects, right?
Yeah, that was human nature. I did study art before I got into architecture. Mm. I was always interested in painting and sculpture and the relationships, but when I started practicing architecture, my first buildings were toxic to my architect colleagues. For some reason, I mean, they were boxes, but they didn't like them. There was funny things they'd say.
But your artist friends would?
The artists were on the construction site.
Yeah.
They weren't friends. I didn't know them. I knew who they were.
Yeah.
And I'd find Ed Moses and Larry Bell and Kenny Price, people like coming to the job site. Yeah. And I thought, gee, these guys like me. I better hang out with them. I like them too.
They like people like me.
Yeah, so that's how that happened. And I think that fork in the road for me was probably what made me go off in these directions.
You can look, if you look at moments, if you look at critical times, turns, that association with art.
Right, is very critical.
Mendelssohn.
Yeah. I think the artist more than that. Security of having a claque, a group that would support you, would say, gee, that's good. At that time, in that very infant state of what I was doing, was really important to me.
Has there built up a series of ideas about who Frank Gehry is that you don't recognize, that you find even alien to who you are and what you believe? For example, you know, the notion that, you know, that you don't care about warmth and you don't care about, you know, inviting you in and all those kinds of ideas.
Those are, I call it simplistic, illiterate kind of notions.
But people project onto you.
Yeah, well, like my house was done with corrugated metal and chain link. So everybody assumed that was antithetical to any kind of humanist thing. But when they came in the house, they said, oh my goodness, this is warm and cuddly and fuzzy and all that thing.
Yeah.
So I did get a kind of a rap. The other rap I got and still get is that, and maybe this show will counter some of that, that they, because the paper looks, it looks like some of these models look like they're thrown together and in a quiet, you know, after smoking something, that's how I do my buildings, crumpled paper, and you can see from that I do hundreds of models. So
that's what I want to ask, as you go from these, it's an extraordinary walk down. You know.
I can't go look at it.
You can't? Oh, come on.
Well, I'm having a hard time with it.
Are you?
Really.
Because you see, A, unfinished business.
Yes.
What else?
It's mucking around in my past, and I want to, you know, go forward. I don't want to waste time there.
Do you, you're 71?
72.
72. Do you have a sense that, I don't have time for this, folks.
Yeah.
I've reached a point where I've got so much I want to do. Yeah. I've built, I've learned, I've got, I mean, I just want to spend all my time.
Right. You know? That's the way I feel. And with my family and my work.
Your family and work. Yeah. Those I love and the work I love.
Right.
And get on with it.
Get
because
on with
you
it.
Never know.
Right.
It may be 20 years, it may be 5 years, it may be, you know.
And I love...
And this reminds you of history. It also reminds you of unfinished.
Yes. And, I mean, there are a lot of good memories here. And
yeah.
I'm grateful that he did the show. I didn't want him to do the show. I begged him to leave me alone because...
We're talking about Tom Krenz.
Tom Krenz.
Who runs the Guggenheim.
Runs Guggenheim.
And all the little Guggenheims.
But... And he had his reasons for wanting it, but, and I'm grateful to him, but it still took an enormous distraction from work. I've lost a lot of time from the new projects. And
you have to sit around with people like me.
Right.
Take time to explain yourself.
Well, this morning I was interviewed by 10 people in a row, and they all asked the same questions, and you just... So I make up different
stories.
Tell
me what they ask, so I won't ask those questions. Tom Krenz is... That's the best working relationship you've ever had in your life.
He's great.
Or as good as anything.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
And I he's complicated, as I am to him. He's complicated to me. But he's brilliant. He's willing to walk off a cliff. He's willing to try things.
Yeah.
He sometimes will start something not knowing where he's going to get the money to do it.
Yeah.
He somehow manages. When he told me about Bilbao originally, I thought he was nuts.
Originally?
And I heard all kinds of backbiting stuff, you know, around him. You can't do this, blah, 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 blah. Well, he did it. And, you know, he caused Mass Mocha to happen. And he's,
what does it mean to you to build? Guggenheim waterfront.
I'm sure it's the most important thing in my life, but I'm trying not to think about it.
Why?
If I worry about it, and it doesn't, I mean, I could invest a lot of time worrying about it. So I'm just taking my cues from Tom. Whenever he says, pushes a button, says, do this or get something ready, I do it.
It's part of the cause.
Yeah, yeah.
But when you think of the size of it, it's twice as big as Guggenheim Bilbao.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Twice.
But it's interesting if it comes off, to be building over the water, to be dealing with it as an example of how to build on the waterfront of a city like New York without losing the public access to the waterfront, of making a cultural venue that people can come to without paying to get in. They can enjoy the grounds of the cultural venue. They can enjoy some of the fruits of it without having to go up and if they don't want to see the show, they can at least bring kids. And over time, the kids grow up and we'll feel comfortable going in there.
New York Times said, when this new Guggenheim makes obvious, what this new Guggenheim makes obvious is the degree to which, architecturally speaking, New York has not been the cultural capital of the world, has been in fact more than a little parochial, speaking of architecture. Neither this building alone nor the other important architectural commissions afoot in the city will alter that fact immediately.
Right.
Well, it's clear that was true about Bilbao, too, even yeah. more so. But this is an opportunity for you as a capstone in a career to put an imprint on the world's greatest city, but a city that has a paucity.
Yeah. But it's my father's city. My father was born here.
You were born
Hell's
in
Kitchen.
You were born in Canada.
Yeah.
He was born here.
Yeah.
So where in your heart?
And I lived here when I was a year old. He had me living here on Avenue J in Flatbush, somewhere like that.
So this has multiple.
Yeah, it's got emotional things.
Yeah. And, a great city of Jewish immigration.
Right. But plus the, it's the art. The, a lot of my friends are here.
Yeah.
And I love them.
So this means more than you're going to let on, doesn't
right,
it?
Right, right. But I can't let myself get caught in it until it's real because, can you imagine the disappointment?
This is certainly, that is so huge and so significant and I guess the backdrop of such a magnificent place.
Right.
Inhabited by so many kindred souls for you.
Right.
I also read, though, that you want to do more things of human scale.
Well, I want everything to be of human scale, whether it's big or small. But no, I've been doing, since Bilbao, I've accepted a lot of small projects. Like, this is my do-gooder shtick. So I'm doing the Ronald McDonald House in Bad Oeynhausen for the place where the families of kids who, babies, have transplant hearts.
Instead.
That's nearly built.
You do that for the
and then Maggie Jenks little cancer clinic, not a clinic, it's a clubhouse in Scotland. I need to. That's how I pay back or do whatever.
Yeah, is to take those little things and
make them. And we're doing a project now in Biloxi, Mississippi. It's a. It turns out it was one museum in the program, but it had three. Components: African art, which is American African art, and contemporary art, and a George Orr, the Mad Potter of Biloxi. And I loved his work. I love his work. Yeah. You know, David Whitney and Jasper Johns collected.
Yeah.
They gave me a site that's filled with live oak trees, and you can't go next to them or be in the drip line. So it broke it down into three little buildings.
Yeah.
And I'm very excited. It's a whole conglomeration and a cluster.
How are you handling this thing that's this sort of Gehry phenomenon? You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah, I do. I'm trying to...
You got the famous filmmaker, Sidney Pollack. Sidney Pollack.
Well, he's just an old friend.
But he's a famous filmmaker. I mean, he made Tootsie.
And this is Tootsie, too.
I mean, he's making a film about your life, for goodness sakes.
It's because you didn't do it.
And you're so much better off, I promise. Even though he's never made a documentary, he'll need some coaching.
Right.
But we'll help him along.
Okay.
But this phenomenon of Gehry, how are you handling that?
Well, I think if I was younger, I would be in trouble. But since I am 72...
You mean you'd be using it like crazy?
Yeah.
Hello, I'm Frank Gehry.
Yeah, I'm trying to ignore it as best I can.
You are handling it well. Everybody I know that loves you, knows you, thinks, you have every reason to be out.
I know.
Arrogant, unapproachable. I mean, like Frank Lloyd Wright was.
Right. But that's a different time, I think.
Yeah.
I don't.
You're enjoying it, though.
I enjoy
the fact that now you can build wherever you want to.
Yeah.
I mean,
I enjoy the fact that they call me into Lincoln Center and ask me to kibitz on the side. I don't know if anything will happen, but that's pretty exciting to play with those guys. And L.A. is starting to treat me like a human being.
At long last.
Yeah. And so I'm enjoying that. They're treating me nice.
Here's what I like about you too. I mean, we're in this building, and there is all of this. You get to see process. Process. Mm-hmm. Which is fundamental, you know?
Right.
You don't just say, I want this. You have to understand and want the process that takes you there.
Yep.
Right?
But that works with bringing the client in as a partner, because it's all these models that when I make them and explain them, and it shows the client what I'm thinking, it also shows them that I'm not fixed on something, that I'm struggling to solve their problem. It's not just I'm coming in with a thing and saying take it or leave it,
yeah,
or a preconception. I'm trying to noodle it in some way that fits the things they're asking for. And I love that interaction. So the models are not only used for me to find out where I'm going, because I don't know where I'm going. If I knew where I was going, I wouldn't go there. So I'm exploring some kind of unknown territory with the models, but I'm exposing that feeling, that uncertainty to the client. I found that really is helpful. They don't...
Not only helpful, but essential.
Essential for my work, because at the end of the process, they're part of it, and quite often feel like they designed it.
And that's okay with you?
That's fine with me.
Paul Allen.
Ah.
A rather quiet.
Shy.
Didn't want to do this face-to-face.
Not too much.
We'll communicate by email.
Yeah.
That's his medium.
Well, I had some meetings with him.
No, but didn't you insist on it?
Yes,
my point.
Yes,
my point is that you insisted on it. You basically said, I'm not going to design the building.
I won't do it
in Seattle.
Right, unless I can.
Unless you come and see and talk to me about what you want and see what I do.
Right.
We have to understand, at least from the beginning, where we both are coming from and who we are.
That's essential. That's probably why I can't do corporate work, because you get the executive vice president and then the CEO comes in at the end, and you've got this thing, and he doesn't know how it got to look like that. Hasn't been in the... it just doesn't work. They've got to be in it from the beginning. They've got to participate. And Paul did, to a certain extent, not as much as I would like him to. I always think the building could have been better, but I think it could have been even better than...
You even think that about Bilbao?
Yeah, I do. I
mean, you see I don't know whether they're mistakes, but things that you might...
They're not mistakes. I've grown past, I've solved, I've done things.
No.
I can see how I can make it better.
Now. Would you have still
have
built...
That's why I don't want to look at these things.
Yeah. Would you still have built that huge, huge, huge gallery?
That was Tom's gallery.
For sculpture.
I didn't want to build that huge, huge gallery. This is the one thing that he and I have fought about on the project. And I had designed it so that it would have three or four walls, so you created an enfilade. Yeah. So there would be several rooms. And I think it will look bigger with those walls.
He doesn't.
And he doesn't. And I see that that room overpowers the art that's in it, including the Richard Serres.
Including Richard Serres, whose sculpture is as big as they can get.
Yeah, but it overpowers it, in my opinion. Now, very few people agree with me, or maybe they do and I don't know.
But you haven't changed your mind.
No, I really haven't. Listen, my show is going there, and I'm refusing to put it in that gallery.
This will not be in that gallery.
No.
There is justice in
this. Yes.
You could have my show, but not in that gallery. Is this your creation? Is this Bruce Mao's creation? This is Gehry Associates' creation?
This is Gehry Associates, but it's first of all, Mickey Friedman, who was the curator at the Walker, the wife of Martin Friedman, who used to be the director. They did my show there years ago, the first show.
Now, what's the vision here?
The vision here, I said to Edwin Chan, my young friend, designer, partner, who's been with me 15 years, I said, Edwin, pretend I'm dead and do it.
That's great.
And I have tried to stay
out. And know that I'm going to come back and look. Yeah,
and I love it. I hugged him the other day. And, you know, he's had trouble with this. Yeah. And I sort of warned him that it wasn't going to work, but I let him...
The trouble is it hadn't arrived, or was it
You know, when you do something like this, you got
this meaning the hanging...
The hanging schmata, as I call
whatever
it.
Whatever you call it. Yeah.
If you're going to do something like that, there's a whole technology and an engineering thing, and, you know, and you got to really study it and test it. And he did quite a bit. But I sort of knew he was going to have trouble with it. But yeah. He'll make it work.
But people like it.
I know. Well, it'll work for what he wants.
Now, people read in things into it, too. Yeah. They think it's some this metallic that goes back to chain link and
right,
all that.
Right.
Is that what...
And sailboats and stuff
sailboats
like that. What Edwin wanted to do was make a domed ceiling that relate within the Frank Lloyd Wright. So it would be like a vision of Brunelleschi in a shadow, in a ghost of Brunelleschi looking at it from the inside. Inside, he was transforming the Frank Lloyd Wright, and it really worked on all the little models. And in a few weeks, I promise you, it'll work. But right now,
during the life of this exhibition,
yeah, they're going to keep working
work.
On it. Yes, I hope so.
Listen to this quote about you. He does not want to be seen as a lone heroic figure who designs grandiose pieces of sculpture, but as an architect who has figured out how to make altogether new forms and shapes that also manage to do a lot of the things that everyone else, that every other building does. Is that fair?
Yeah.
You resent it. You find it uninformed and wrong when people say, Gehry is a sculptor, he's not a builder.
The reason I do is, I find that as dismissive.
Yeah.
Of architecture, because architecture is a three-dimensional thing, and it was always sculpture, by definition. I thought. I don't see any difference. I mean, I'm not doing what Richard Serra's doing. He's dealing with a whole other culture of galleries and patrons, and I'm dealing with keeping the rain out. But after I keep the rain out, and after I solve the budget, I'm getting close to doing what Richard Serra's doing.
After
I saw them.
After you take care of function.
Right. And so that interests me. Now, you see Frank Stella today has a piece that's approaching architecture, a piece that he's done for the
Washington. What does that say?
And he's always been fascinated with architecture.
And a great friend of yours.
Yeah, and I applaud what he's doing. And I think Serra also likes to play at the edge of architecture, but he's got this religious set of rules that he follows.
Some people, this is also said about you, quote from you, everybody else is ready for the end. Mm-hmm. I'm just beginning.
Who said that? I said
that? You said that.
How clever.
But you feel that a little bit, don't you? I mean... Or not?
Well, I have a great...
Are you thinking about the end? Are you thinking about...
Well, when you get to be 72 and you start to...
It's closer there than the
get
beginning.
Get a few creaks and when you get out of the car, you get... But I have a great role model, two of them. Philip Johnson.
95.
And he's going strong and he's working and you can get him excited. I was at lunch with him the other day. We talked about a new thing, and he's all ready to go.
Right.
And Milton Wexler, who is a psychologist, who I wouldn't say he treated me, but he was like the elder in the family. He's 93, and he still sees patients. I don't go as I've never, but he's like an advisor, and he's going and working. And so, if you hang around with older people,
So what do you most want to accomplish now?
I don't do that. I don't want something.
You don't really?
Because if I do, I'll be disappointed, so I don't want to.
You don't want something?
I'm sort of have a superstition about that.
So what do?
So I just take what comes. If somebody calls me and they want to do something, if I like them, I'll take it. If I don't, I won't.
Is that the way you play it?
Yep. I've always done that.
If I like them, I'll do it.
Yes. Yeah. Yes.
Look out here, and just when I say these words, tell me what comes to your mind. Los Angeles.
That's the most difficult one you picked. I had a hell of a time with that thing. But it's getting built now, the Disney Concert Hall. And what saved that for me is one person, Diane Disney Miller, the daughter of Walt, who I wasn't allowed to meet with in the earlier part of the process. But when I finally did, I found an extraordinary ally. Extraordinary. And she's just like her old man, tough, smart, because she was a woman, she didn't do what she could have done.
Yeah, but she didn't become the...
Yeah, but she has been a great ally, and it's because of her I stuck with it.
God, truly. It must be maddening that you couldn't have gotten together with her earlier.
Yeah, they wouldn't let me. The handler said, don't talk to her.
I don't know what's over there. I can't see. Seattle.
Seattle was Paul Allen. We've talked a little bit about him. I would like to do another thing with him, but really get more involvement from him
and his sister.
Yeah, she was great too.
Yeah. Bilbao.
Bilbao has
changed my life.
The greatest thing of my life. Yeah. And it's Tom, and it's Juan Ignacio Vidarte, and it's the Basques. I love them. I mean, we became a family. I go there and hang out.
Hang out?
Yep.
They must think it's the greatest thing ever.
Yeah.
The Basque.
Right.
Do they?
I think so. Yeah. I mean, but they don't want me to do another one there. There are other buildings they're building, and I...
They don't want you to do it.
I said I'd like to do the tower, and they gave it to Cesar Pelli, but...
Why?
They said they didn't want... They wanted to mix
the
masters.
They don't want Gehry competing with Gehry is what they don't want either.
Probably, yeah. They want to mix the masters, they said. It's strange. So that's happening all over. If you do something in one city, that city only wants one of you. I'm in that category.
You've got enough cities to go around.
Okay.
You got one in Paris.
Yeah, but that's...
And that's not one that you...
That failed.
Yeah, and you spent a year of your life, 61 to 62, in Paris. A city you love.
Right. I love it, yeah.
Right?
Right.
You'd still like to work in Paris?
I go there a lot. I like it.
You'd like to build something there?
Yes, but that one was tough.
Chicago.
Great. I love Mayor Daley. I love Cindy Pritzker, who's putting up the money, the Pritzker family. The park, the notion of building this thing in the park. The idea that I got into enticing the Chicago... This is my thing now. Nobody else... I want to entice the Chicago Symphony to play here.
Oh, I saw it. Oh,
I don't know if Barenboim is still going to be the conductor there, but I think it would be great. They don't have to go up to Ravinia. They can come here.
Just come here
in Chicago.
And you might come to
this little facility.
In Chicago
and play out in the park. Many more people.
Yeah.
15,000. And we're doing something with the sound system. We're building a fancy sound system that with distribution out on the lawn, so people 300 or 400 feet from the stage will hear the sound the same way.
New York, we talk about. It could be a crowning achievement because of the city and the place, and we hope it happens.
The one disappointment was the New York Times building.
Talk about that.
It was a mismatch, and I realized, and David Childs and I worked together on it, I think it's one of the best things I've ever done. And I told David, I guess if I do my best work working with him, we should work together more often. It felt wrong that they had set up a process and a meeting schedule and a way of doing it that would have been antithetical to the way I work.
What was wrong with it was that was the developer, not the New York Times.
It wasn't the developer. You can't blame. It wasn't the ugly developer.
Okay.
He was a good guy.
What was it?
Bruce Ratner, I would say, is a very erudite, intelligent.
Okay, fair enough. Then the record is...
No. I haven't seen him since then, but...
But what's the problem then? It's the best building you've ever done, perhaps?
They were asking me to be in New York every Monday at 2 o'clock, and I said, well, I can't. And they said, well, that's the way we're going to run it. And I realized, and there were a lot of things like that.
Is they Arthur? Is it...
No, it was just the group. I don't know who it was.
Yeah. But they wanted you to be
nice
in New York.
People, funny interest, funny way of dealing with it.
Come on. For the sake of a 2 o'clock meeting on Monday in New York, there's no Gehry building housing the New York Times.
Right.
For the sake of a 2 o'clock meeting in New York.
Well, there were about
Monday?
Three more things.
Like?
I can't remember.
But it was, they loved the building.
They did.
You were the first choice.
I think so.
You were.
Yeah.
I think so, too.
Yeah.
It didn't happen because of a conflict about
how to
process.
Do it. Process, right. And I didn't see a way with the people they put on in front of me of confronting it, of doing it. And we had an 11th hour decision because had they picked us and announced it and I had gotten into trouble with their way of doing it, we would have withdrawn. And David and I thought the gentlemanly thing to do was withdraw before they announced it so we didn't embarrass them. And that's why we did it that way.
Will that building fit anywhere else?
No. It's the New York Times. It really is a branded for them. It was absolutely designed for them. Newsroom, everything. Just I don't know, unless the Globe and Mail in Toronto.
Well, but you'd like to do something in
I
Toronto,
would like to do.
In Canada.
Problem there is the dollar difference. So if they hire you, they have to pay more because I'm working in the States. Mm-hmm.
You left Canada when you were 17 to come to Los Angeles.
Right.
You have said, if I'd stayed in Canada...
I wouldn't be me.
It wouldn't be me.
No. I've told them that. And because their approach to building and architecture is very conservative and very... I don't know. The culture isn't there to... Wouldn't have been there to allow the exploration that I've had the pleasure of, doing.
A terrible indictment of the Canadian culture. But you do want to go back.
I do.
And you still feel it's a hometown.
Right. Some of me does.
Some of you does. You got lots of friends there.
Got relatives there.
Yeah.
I have a cousin who's the cabinet post. I mean, I have some fancy relatives.
All right, but I want to just go back to the New York Times. I mean, how painful was that? Can you take that lightly?
No.
Pushing away?
No. It was very difficult.
Wretchy.
Yeah. And in hindsight, we probably should have gone to another meeting and talked about it.
My sentiments exactly.
And, but
I'll never forgive you for this.
We had this moment of truth because we heard they were going to announce it.
Yeah.
And we got wind that it was probably going to be us. And we were afraid... How do you confront this after? So we just...
Tell you what I would have done.
Yeah.
I would have said, you've already chosen me, so now let's get this straight.
Yeah, I know. Well, we had the complication of my firm and SOM, too.
Right.
There were complications to work out, and I thought they would get to.
Yeah, but I mean, here was some of the best brain cells you had.
I understand.
Just, I mean, you're not going to make this building now.
I know.
This is like, can we change this?
Yeah, tell him.
Renzo is not going to hear this.
No. I told Renzo I did it for him.
You paved the way for him.
Right.
Because after I've gone through this, they're going to be much more amenable to you.
And they were.
And they were.
They were.
Exactly right.
Yeah, we broke the logjam for him.
For him?
Yeah.
He owes you big time.
I know. Tell him. He sends me grappa and cigars.
Grappa and cigars. That's hardly compensation.
No. Yeah.
But just take this as an architect's lot. There are other buildings here. I sat last night with...
Peter?
Chiat.
Oh, Chiat.
Chiat is not going to see his house.
No.
For his circumstances.
Right.
I guess. More than yours.
Right.
I mean, people
dream. That's a great little house,
People dream.
Right.
And they pour a lifetime of imagination into their home, perfect home. Or, you know, or they pour a lifetime of experience into a building.
Right.
And they don't happen.
But I have a pretty good record.
There's you have a great record.
Few of them.
Yeah. What causes you the most?
Jay is a very close friend.
Yeah.
And, you know, I would do anything for him. So for him not to build it, he's struggling a little with health and stuff.
I know. Let me stay with me for a few minutes now.
Yeah.
Sign new house. Out in my neighborhood, you decided not the right place to build a house that he wanted. But there was a relationship.
Right.
You, Cy, Victoria Newhouse, who's an architectural historian. He's building a fancy new Condé Nast building. Clearly he wants his most esteemed friend and architect to do it. And you say, no, it's not for me. The building.
Oh, no, he didn't ask me to do the building.
He didn't.
He asked me to do the interiors.
Ah.
And I didn't want to do it because it just
a bunch of cubicles.
Yeah, I didn't want to.
But you agreed to do
the cafeteria.
Cafeteria.
Yeah. Well, the problem he posed with the cafeteria was similar to MIT and a lot of other projects. He's saying, I got a culture that's not coming together. If it comes together, I win. If these editors talk to each other, if they mingle, together, they will, things will happen.
That's good. He's right.
And he's right. And I've had that experience before with the Rouse Company years ago.
Jim Rouse.
So we made a cafeteria that everybody would want to be in, that had 50 power tables, so there was no hierarchical thing. He put his money on the line. He put a lot of extra into it, probably twice as much as what a normal cafeteria would have cost.
Yeah, you brought materials across the country.
We did everything. And he was a great client. He asked tough questions. He spent a lot of time looking in the models. He's a very smart guy, as you know. So, and very, very well educated about architecture and stuff. And he asked, and there were some interesting moments, like the whole glass thing was very precarious technologically. We didn't know how we were going to do it because the glass gets torqued and it could crack. And we had a few breakage. I didn't have a plan B. I didn't have another idea for it. So if it didn't, and I told him that. I said, if this doesn't work, I don't know where we're going.
There's no fallback.
Yeah, but Randy, my partner, made it work. He discovered a little joint thing.
You were doing some wineries.
I love wine.
So do I. Yeah. Wine is sort of like art.
Yeah.
I mean, it's sort of like architecture. It's a little bit commerce and a little bit of art.
Right.
Or it's halfway between, or it's
But again, the people, this young couple, the Asnars, very wealthy family. The father lost everything, big shipping magnate. This kid is coming back and he's going to build the whole thing, the empire back. He inherited the winery. It was not doing well. He and his wife decided to build it up. They went to the Basque president and asked him to introduce us. It was tiny. It was a little job in Spain. I thought, I can't do this. It's just, by the time I charge them for the traveling and the stuff, they're going to hate me. So I told them all that. And no, they wanted it. So they brought out a bottle of 1929, my year, wine.
Yes. And it's over. You're in.
I was in. And I've had a lot of fun with him.
You've never had the dream. I only two more questions. You've never had the dream to find some perfect spot for you and your family and build something for Frank.
Yeah, the shoemaker problem.
Really?
Well, the house we live in is very comfortable. The kids like it. Berta likes it.
Nice place, nice location.
Yeah, it's okay. I have some land in Montana, near up, I think Brokaw's 4 miles from me.
Yeah.
I'm partners in. and I could go there, but it's 4 hours by plane.
You're not going to do it.
I'm not going to do it. So, I don't know. I bought a sailboat, a new one. I love sailing. That's what I do.
Because it's motion. It's all those things.
Yeah. And I've been sailing for 30 years. So. That's where I go.
Sailing.
Yeah.
He seems almost obsessed with moving on. The greatest goal, it would seem to be, is putting feeling and thinking together.
Okay.
That's it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
It's a great pleasure.
My friend, thank you. Frank Gehry for the hour. Thank you for joining us.